Good morning, everybody. Welcome to Orange Congregational Church, United Church of Christ. I'm Victoria Ramsey, the Director of Faith Formation here. We here at Orange OCC are an open and affirming congregation, and that means that no matter who you are, no matter where you are on life's journey, you are welcome here. We're a congregation that practices the extravagant welcome of God to people of every race, class, ancestry, sexual orientation, gender, gender identity, age, marital status, economic circumstances, and physical, emotional, and mental ability. No matter who you are or what life is like for you these days, you are welcome here, and we are so glad to have you. I'm not aware of any extra announcements this morning, but if you have some, let me know. Gretchen?
Hi, everybody. As you may or may not know, I am the church school coordinator here at OCC, and I am always looking for folks who are willing to teach alongside me via Zoom right now for our children for Sundays. We meet at 11:30 on Sundays for church school. So if you're so willing and would like to give it a shot, give it a try. I'm there, and you can do it from your home, you can do it from wherever you are, or via Zoom. So let me know if you might be interested.
There are lots and lots of announcements in the bulletin, and so we hope that you take a look at that. We are one congregation in many places. We are one congregation gathered here and one congregation worshiping through YouTube or the internet at home. If you are a visitor with us, we extend an especially warm welcome.
I'm going to say hi to Tyler.
I'm going to call him out. Nancy and I met him this week, and we're so happy you're here. If there are any other visitors here, we're happy to see you as well, and we can't wait to say hi and get to know you a little bit. This is Reverend Jen's last Sunday on vacation, and we are gifted this morning to have the Reverend Frank Basler with us in worship. Frank is a graduate of Yale Union Theological Seminary and MIT and has a certificate in psychoanalysis from the Westchester Institute. After seminary, Frank founded the Rochester Downtown Ecumenical Ministry, and he currently facilitates a community of practice for senior ministers and is building his psychotherapy practice. And we are so happy to have you with us in worship today. All those who wait for the Lord, all those who hunger and thirst and yearn for the presence of God are welcome here, where the presence of God has already met us. Welcome to worship.
Thank you. Good morning. Please join me for our call to worship this morning. How beautiful are the places where you dwell, O Lord. Happy are those who find their strength in you. Please stand as you are able for the singing of our first hymn.
God, bread of heaven, we hunger and thirst for your abundant life. We bring you our sorrow and anxiety and ask for the bread of joy. We bring you our despair and worry and ask for the bread of hope. We bring you our weariness and ask for the bread of inspiration. Meet us here. Grace us the bread of heaven to sustain us for our journey, to find our way, to find our way to you,
to find our way so that
we may become one with you. And as we strive to be one people, we pray with one voice the prayer you taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. For our stewardship moment this morning, we have Rachel Braden, who will come talk about what it means to her to be rooted in love. And as she makes her way up here, I will light our candle of witness.
Good morning. My name is Rachel Raiden, and I want to thank you for this opportunity to speak about giving during our pledge drive. The theme for stewardship this year is Rooted in Love, and I thought I would tell you a little bit about myself and my stewardship journey. The seeds were planted early for me. My family was Episcopalian, and we were active in church. I remember my father being on the board of stewardship, and he went to each parishioner's home to speak to them individually about the importance of giving and pledging. As a young adult, I did not go to church. I married my husband, Alan, who was raised in a Jewish home. We planned to expose our children to both Christianity and Judaism and let them make up their own decisions about what to believe. I was branching out religiously. When my son and daughter were little, I started looking for a church and came here to the OCC first and never left. I came here initially because the building is beautiful and attractive.
But when I saw inside the doors, I loved
even more. I felt accepted here in part because of our belief that no matter who you are or where you are in life's journey, you are welcome here. At that time, I was not a member, and I gave cash when they passed the collection plate. My children thrived in Sunday school and youth group. We all participated in serving at Columbus House and singing to shut-ins at Christmas time. This is when I started to pledge and give consistently to the church. I could feel my family growing and becoming deeply rooted in love at church. I began to give my time and talents too as a Sunday school teacher and member of the Christian Ed Board. My children are now in their 20s and experimenting with not attending church regularly. I take comfort in knowing that the seeds that were planted here are still inside them and bearing fruit. You never know when you plant something how it will grow. In fact, I was surprised when my husband chose to be baptized
here about 2 years ago.
Since the pandemic, we have all been challenged to rethink how we gather and worship and as a church community. I came to love being able to watch the service on my computer at home. I could attend worship in my pajamas, on the couch with a cup of coffee and my dog. And many people are still taking advantage of that option. For those of you who watch from home, I especially want to encourage you to pledge. You can think of it as a streaming service like Netflix. You can pledge electronically, and it's easy and convenient. I could go on and on about the things I love about the OCC and the reasons why I pledge, but I'll end by saying that the church has helped me and my family to become deeply rooted in love and faith. Giving to this church brings me happiness because it allows us to grow and thrive in our relationships with each other and with God. Thank you.
Comes the juggle, the juggle of the microphones. Sorry about that. Good morning. How's everyone today?
Good.
And on this chilly November morning, feels nice though. Feels about like finally fall, doesn't it? So I was thinking, you know, it's interesting perspectives that we can have, right? When you see something happen, especially it's something that might surprise you, we can all see it in different ways. We all could be witnessing the same thing, but our take on it can be very different. So let's say that, like, you know, you're watching with a group of your friends, somebody skateboarding along. This is mostly geared towards young people, sorry, because, you know, I am the children's ministry person. And this person who's skateboarding along falls right off their skateboard, you know. As children, most of us would probably laugh first. You know, somebody's misfortune is usually very funny, but we all might be then asked to say, gee, what happened? You know, someone might come along and say, what happened here? One person might say, well, you know, he seemed to like hit a little bump in the path there and it flew him off. Another person might even say, well, there was somebody walking by and it kind of distracted them and they fell off their skateboard. And another person might even say something different. They might say that they were like trying some trick that was too difficult for them and they ended up falling off their skateboard. Same event, but very different views of how it happens. This can happen quite a bit, and this can even happen when it gets to be something serious, like being called to like a court of law to testify, right? When we testify, we're there to tell the truth, right? And that's what we say we're going to do. We're going to tell the truth if we testify. And testifying can look very different for different people, even though it's the same thing going on. It doesn't mean they're lying. It doesn't mean that it's not true. It just means it's their perspective. So we can all be counted on to testify to our beliefs and to what we know to be true about God. And that doesn't mean that if you have a different belief or a different view of it, that it's wrong or you're lying. It's just the way you see it. So we all want to remember that the one thing that we could be sure of, though, is that God's message to us is always true. And that message is love. God's love for us. We can always count on that testimony to be true. So that's my message for today. I hope you enjoy. Thank you.
Hear the word of the Lord from 1 John chapter 5. If we take human testimony at face value, how much more should we be reassured when God gives testimony that he does hear, or as he does hear, testifying concerning his Son? Whoever believes in the Son of God inwardly confirms God's testimony. Whoever refuses to believe, in effect, calls God a liar, refusing to believe God's own testimony regarding God's Son. This is the testimony in essence. God gave us eternal life. The life is in God's Son. So whoever has the Son has life. Whoever rejects the Son rejects life. My purpose in writing is simple, that you who believe in God's Son will know beyond the shadow of a doubt that you have eternal life. The reality is not the reality and not the illusion. And how bold and free we then become in God's presence.
Well, the author of this letter is sure convinced about eternal life. He's absolutely certain that he and other members of the early church have life eternal. And he's not the only one. The Apostle Paul is utterly convinced that we have eternal life. He says in Romans, "For the wages of sin is death. But the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord." And listen also to what Jesus tells Nicodemus in this soaring passage in John. "For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life." These are powerful testimonies. And Gretchen told us that testimony is something that is true. These are powerful testimonies that Jesus and Paul and the author of today's letter give us. If we trust what they are telling us, if we quote unquote believe in God's Son, we will know beyond the shadow of a doubt that we have eternal life. The author then adds, "And how bold and free we then become in his presence." Bold and free. In my therapy practice, I've been seeing a man for well over a year who's just tied up in knots over his financial difficulties. He would love to be bold and free. Been a pretty tough year, right? Perhaps some of you have things that you worry about that keep you from feeling free. And like my client, I'll bet you hardly ever think about eternal life, let alone have unshakable faith that it is yours. So what I'd like to do this morning
is offer some
good news about living in eternity. It's good news that you and I can use to give us the courage to face the challenges in our lives. I'd like to give testimony or bear witness to the good news that you and I can live lives of freedom from anxiety. All we have to do is trust what Jesus and Paul and the author of today's scripture reading are saying about eternal life. And what they're saying is not easy, all that easy to grasp, but it's really important. It can help us live full, whole lives. The authors of the Bible sure thought that trusting in eternal life was important.
Saying about
eternal life. Well, we can be pretty sure that they're not talking about heaven. They're not talking about what happens to us after we die. Jesus hardly ever talks about heaven or hell. What he does talk about is the kingdom of God. He says that's the reason for his ministry. He mentions it 100 times. He says that proclaiming the arrival of the kingdom is why he came to do his ministry. What he says about the kingdom is that it is here and now, in our midst. It's not in the future after we die. In Luke 17, when Pharisees asked when the kingdom of God would come,
Jesus answered them by saying,
"The coming of the kingdom of God is not something that can be observed, nor will people say, 'Here it is,' or 'There it is,' because the kingdom of God is in your midst." It's right here. So if eternal life is not about going to heaven after we die, well, what is it about? The comparative religion professor Joseph Campbell described it in his TV series, The Power of Myth. Any of you remember that way back in the, I think probably in the 60s, early 70s? Campbell said, eternity is not some later time. Eternity isn't even a long time. Eternity has nothing to do with time. Eternity is that dimension
of here and now
that all thinking in temporal terms cuts off. It is the experience of eternity right here now. He's saying that eternity is something that we experience when our focus is on the present moment, when we let go of thoughts about the past, and let go of thoughts about both the past and the future, and focus on what is before us here and now. Allow me to offer some of my own testimony. It comes from my meditation practice. My intention when I pray and sit is to be in the present moment and pay attention to the coming and the going of my thoughts. It's like watching clouds pass by. I become still
and watch those thoughts
pass by without getting hooked on any of them. Psalm 46, in that psalm, God says, "Be still and know that I am God." That still point of awareness in the present moment is what theologians and mystics have long called the eternal now. It's what Campbell calls the experience of eternity right here and now in all things. As I meditate and still my thoughts, I'm experiencing eternity. Eternity is a present moment experience available to you and me in prayer and every time we stop to smell the roses. Try it for yourself.
For 5 seconds.
Take a deep breath. Allow your attention to focus on this candle. See it flicker? Feel the peace. Know that you are in eternity right now. You're in eternity every time you give your undivided attention to anything. Yesterday, as I was cutting back our rose bushes, I was giving them my complete attention. I was in eternity. And then I remembered that I was in eternity. When you're in the present moment, trusting that this moment is an eternal moment.
It's a real rush.
Just now, when you were looking at the candle and being still, you truly were in eternity. But it's amazing when you think about it that way. So try it again. Pay attention to the flickering of the candle. Be aware that your consciousness is in the present moment. Now, consider that this present moment is an eternal moment, that you and I are here and now in eternity. Recently, a friend invited us over to see her new puppy. While we talked, it fell asleep in her arms, and as she looked at it with love in her eyes, in that moment, our friend was in eternity. No past, no future, just the beauty, and sometimes the pain of the present moment. That puppy isn't easy. It bites. It chews everything. Yes, it's in the beauty and the pain of the present moment that we experience eternity. I once had a powerful experience of eternity when I was praying. I was focused on being aware of my awareness, which is a good way of staying in the present, adding that being aware of your consciousness. And at one point, I lost focus, and my mind wandered. And out of nowhere, a thought passed through my head. "Don't leave me," it said. "Don't leave me." Where did that thought come from? It was like the voice of God calling, imploring me to stay connected. I felt so loved. The universe, with a capital U, is personal. God wants me, and God wants you to remain in the present moment, connected to the beauty and the pain of the unity of all things. God wants us to enjoy eternal life. The writer of today's letter says, "My purpose in writing is simply this, that you who believe in God's Son will know beyond the shadow of a doubt that you have eternal life, the reality and not the illusion."
And then it goes on to say,
how bold and free we become in His presence. That may seem like a leap, but think about it. What allows us to be bold and free is realizing that life never ends. It is eternal life. Remember what we hear at Easter? Death, where is thy sting? Death, where is thy victory? My experience of God seeming to say, "Don't leave me," is freeing. I don't need to be anxious about anything. As I grow older, my joints creak more, my vertigo gets worse, my memory gives me more and more problems.
The experience
of an eternity united to a loving, personal universe, a universe with a capital U, erases all those fears. Yes, I'm going to get old and feeble and die. So what? I can live boldly with whatever faculties I still have. I can trust eternal life. Let us pray. Holy One, help us to live our lives boldly. Free us from our anxiety. Remind us to return to your presence in the present moment so that we can experience eternity with you. Remind us that as we focus on anything in the here and now, We are actually in eternity.
Yes, you are.
Amen.
Will you pray with me? Almighty God, your presence knows no bounds. As we dwell together in that presence, knowing that no matter where we may go, we may still be found in that presence, we thank you. We thank you for what you have blessed us with, great and small. And yet, as we sit in the space of gratitude, we also hold in tension the many ways that our souls can mirror the chaotic world
that we live in.
Holy God, settle our hearts and our minds. When possible, give us just a glimpse of your divine peace. Wrap us up in your love as if it was a warm comforter at the end of a long, cold November day. Because, Lord, we are so weary. And God, we pray for our leaders, both around the world, in our nation, and our communities, and in our church. Guide them in the ways of self-sacrificial love. Protect them in body and spirit, and empower them to fight for justice. Lord, we also lay bare before you the many ways that your church has failed to live up to your calling, both in the past and the present. We lament the ongoing sins of white supremacy and racism, sexism and systemic misogyny,
anti-LGBTQ violence,
ableism and classism. We ask that you would empower this church to continue to stand against these egregious things and to act as a beacon of hope to those with whom the church has hurt. And as the weather changes, we thank you for the beauty of this world. However, we acknowledge that the chilly air and the vibrant leaves mean something so much more sinister to those in our community who experience homelessness and poverty. And so, Lord, provide for them even now as they brace themselves for the upcoming winter, and move within our hearts and our minds for those of us who have the privilege of a warm place to lay our heads at night, so that we may see where you may be calling us to share in bringing a piece of your eternal kingdom here on earth. And Lord, hear our prayers as we lift these names before you,
your throne,
and before our community. We pray for Denise, Pat, Keenan, Rita, Mary and Mike, Goldie, Mary, Sue, Carmella, Evan, Dave, and Pam Corso, all beautiful, beloved children of you, God. Thank you for hearing our prayers, and we say all this in your holy name. Amen.
We who have accepted from God abundant gifts we did not deserve have the opportunity to express our thanks. We who have eaten manna in the wilderness have the opportunity to pass on the bread of life to our neighbors. Will the ushers please come forward as we offer our gifts to God? Thank you, God, for your continuing love. Thank you for the living bread, Jesus Christ, who feeds our spirits. In gratitude for our undeserved grace and unlimited opportunity, we dedicate these offerings of ourselves.
Our time, our money, and our talent.
May our offerings address the needs of many in ways that bring hope, grace, and love to your creation. Amen. And please be seated.
You are invited to eat and drink at the Lord's table. Jesus Christ is the host. We are his guests. He welcomes everyone to come and eat and be nourished. He asks everyone to be fed
and forgiven.
Come and eat and live. The only people that are excluded from this communion table are those that Jesus himself would exclude. And that is no one. All are welcome at this table. Come and be transformed. Come and be transformed into Christ for the world. Let us pray. compassionate God, holy unity. Pour out your spirit upon these gifts of the bread and the cup, prepared for those who love you. As we silence our thoughts
and take deep
breaths to receive your Holy Spirit, we would open our hearts in love to those burdened by hopelessness. We would feed all who hunger. We would reassure all who despair. As we are welcomed at your table and nourished by the cup of life, we would share from our abundance to rebuild the broken lives of the world's poor. We thank you for people of faith in every generation who have given themselves to further your reign of love. We thank you for Jesus the Christ, who you filled with your own being, who shared the sorrows and joys of this human life.
Remember Christ's
death. We celebrate Christ's resurrection. We praise you for the calling forth of your church for its mission in the world. Gifted by the presence of your Holy Spirit, we offer ourselves to you as you transform us into Christ for the world. Amen. We remember how on the night that he was to be betrayed, Jesus ate a special meal with his closest friends. He gathered with them in an upper room to share the feast of his people's liberation. And on that night, Jesus took a
loaf of bread.
He gave thanks. He blessed it. And he broke it, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for the world. Whenever you eat it, remember me." So, let us take and eat. And then he took the cup. He blessed it and passed it to them, saying, This is the cup of the new covenant, sealed in my blood. Whenever you drink of it, remember me. Remember what I have told you." Let us share in the symbolic cup. Please join me in our unison prayer of thanksgiving. We give you thanks, Almighty God, that you have renewed us at your table by granting us the presence of Jesus Christ. Strengthen our faith, increase our love for one another, and send us forth into the world in courage and peace, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit through Jesus Christ our Savior. Amen. May the courage of the early morning's dawning, the strength of the eternal hills and wide open fields, the beauty of the flowered gardens, the love that makes a family and alone can build the peace of the world, the life that is Christ, and the peace of the evening's ending and of the midnight be with you now, forevermore. Amen.